story, The Portrait of a Lady, which is for CBSC class 11, the first of your stories. I'll be going over it. Then I shall go into a detailed explanation about the story and its analysis. Okay. So, let's start with the text. The Portrait of a Lady by Khushwant Singh. Now, the story is narrated by the grandson. It's a presentation and a portrayal of a grandmother. Now, why is it called portrait? Portrait, as you know, is an incomplete presentation. You have of a character. You have only the portrait, only the top portion of a person's body. That is what a portrait is. Here also, you have an incomplete presentation of the life of the grandmother. The grandmother's life is not entirely presented out here. The grandmother's life is not entirely presented out here. She is here presented, as you can see from this text, that from the time when the grandson is born, he sees his grandmother from that time on in her death. That means what we are missing out here? We are missing out her birth. We are missing out her childhood. We are missing out her youthful days. We are missing out the period of her marriage, having children and all those aspects. It's all missing. So what we have is a portrayal of the grandmother or a presentation of the grandmother from the time when the narrator or the grandson sees her till her death. So that's why it's a portrait. It's not a full-fledged picture. Okay. So let's see. My grandmother, like everybody's grandmother, was an old woman. She had been old and wrinkled for the 20 years that I had known her. So for nearly 20 years he has known her now. That means the age of the narrator is nearly 20. And she has been old and wrinkled. She has been the same. She has not aged as per the eyes of the narrator. People said she had once been young and pretty and even had a husband. But that was hard to believe. So here it comes the childhood innocence. He is unable to imagine that his grandmother was once young and pretty and that she had a husband and all that. My grandfather's portrait hung above the mantelpiece in the drawing room. Grandfather's portraits were hanging, he was dead, his portrait was hanging on the mantelpiece. He wore a big turban and loose fitting clothes. Like all Punjabis and Sikh, they wear the pagdi. So he was wearing the turban, as it's called, loose fitting clothes, like those Punjabi clothes that they wear. His long white beard covered the best part of his chest. That means he has a long beard which covered a major portion of his chest. And he looked at least 100 years old. Again, the childhood innocence. Seeing this picture of the grandfather, he thinks he must be 100 years old. He looks so old, he must be 100 years old. He did not look the sort of person who would have a wife or children. That means this is again the childhood perception, innocence, that this man doesn't look to be one who can have a wife, who can have children. No, he is the perfect grandfather character. As for my grandmother, being young and pretty, the thought was almost revolting. Revolting means it kind of clashed with his brain. His brain couldn't imagine his grandmother to be young and pretty. She often told us the games she used to play as a child. That seemed quite absurd and undignified on her part. And we treated it like the fables of the prophets she used to tell us. Just as the tales of the prophets that she used to tell them, the other children of the other cousins also. The grandson didn't believe in the fact that she was once young and she was a child once and she used to play games. This he thought is very undignified on the part of the grandmother. How can she so old and all that? How can she say all these things that I was young and pretty? No, she cannot be young. She cannot be a child. This is his childhood innocence that is preventing him from imagining his grandmother from being a child. We adults can imagine that. But she as a child, he as a child cannot imagine that his grandmother, whom he from his birth he has seen her old, that she was once a child, she was once a wife, she had children, she was married, she had a husband, unimaginable. So he treated and the others also treated these stories like those stories of the prophets, like the Aesop fables, Jataka tales and all. He regarded them like that. She had always been short and fat and slightly bent. These are the words used to describe her. Her face was a crisscross of wrinkles running from everywhere to everywhere. Old people have wrinkles on their faces. If you have seen the picture of Mother Teresa, there are a lot of wrinkles on her face. So here also, she was an old woman and she had wrinkles all over her face. No, we were certain she had always been as we had known her old. So terribly old that she could not have grown older and had stayed at the same age for 20 years. So this is again the childhood innocence and perception coming in. wherein he finds it difficult to imagine that his grandmother is actually grown older than what he had seen him at, he had seen her at the beginning. That means for the last 20 years, according to him, she has not aged. She has remained the same. That is not actually the case, but here, as per his eyes, his perception, he thinks she cannot age anymore. She had reached the extreme limit of aging. She cannot age anymore. So for the last 20 years, she is just as she should be. She could never have been pretty, but she was always beautiful. Now, pretty and beautiful, they are different things. Okay, pretty is something which attracts your eyes. A young girl may be pretty. A heroine may be pretty. That is pretty. But beautiful? Beautiful is something serene. You see a beautiful landscape full of greenery. That is beautiful. You see a sunrise, sunset. That is beautiful. That is not pretty. That is beautiful. Similarly, this grandmother wearing this white dress is a symbol, is a kind of a symbol of purity and beauty in her own way. So, she hobbled about the house in spotless white with one hand resting on her waist to balance her stoop and the other telling the beads of her rosary. So, she was bent with age. It is a stoop that is bent over. You have seen old people bending down over. They cannot walk straight. They are bent down. So, that is a stoop. So, one hand she held her stoop. Okay, and the other hand she had the beads of the rosary. The rosary you have in the Christians have the rosary, we have elders who have the Rudrakshmala and all that. Well, as a rosary, they pray using those beads. So she had that in one hand she balanced her stoop and she walked about in spotless white, which is the symbol of the widows. Widows normally wear white, spotless white she wore. So she was like that. Her silver locks were scattered untidily over a pale, puckered face. Maybe she had lost her teeth. That's why her face had the cheeks had gone inside. It was a puckered face. And her silver locks were scattered. The hair was untidily scattered all over. And her lips constantly moved in inaudible prayer. Inaudible means you couldn't hear it. It's just mumbling, gently. Yes, she was beautiful. She was like the winter landscape in the mountains. Here is the example which I was saying. Beautiful. How beautiful? Winter landscape in the mountains. Winter landscape, you have seen the mountains covered with beautiful ice. That's what he says. An expanse of pure white serenity, breathing peace and contentment. So for this narrator, she was a picture of peace and contentment. She was a symbol of peace and calmness all around. So this is what she was according to the narrator. So seeing her was like seeing the mountain landscape. There's a whole lot of. So, she was like the beautiful, serene mountain range full of snow that you see. She was just like that. She was just like that serene expanse of mountains. Anyway, we continue. My grandmother and I were good friends. They were very good friends. Here in the friendship is there, starts at the beginning when he is very small. My parents left me with her when they went to live in the city and were constantly together. They were constantly together. Why? Mother and father, they went away to the city to make arrangements for the livelihood and they left the child in the care of the grandmother. This is what is missing in modern day life, wherein the nuclear families, the elders are neglected and they are put in old age homes and the children are alone. They do not have any guidance. Earlier, children had these grandparents who used to guide them in their childhood. So here, that thing is being highlighted here. She used to wake me up in the morning, get me ready for school. Very early morning, get up. Habit that she develops in the narrator and makes him get ready for school. She said her morning prayer in a monotonous sing-song while she bathed and dressed me in the hope that I would listen and get to know it by heart. Sing-song means the bhajans and the religious songs sometimes are sung in a very melodious kind of a tune. Why is that so? So that people may easily learn it by heart. And that was exactly the reason why she sang that religious song that she sang or that prayer. Why did she do that? So that the narrator or this her grandson would memorize it by heart. I listened because I loved her voice but never bothered to learn it. But her expectation was not fulfilled because he listened to the song because he wanted to get an idea about it. And he listened to the song just for the sake of getting to enjoy that sweet voice of hers. But on the other hand, the narrator's grandmother's objective was not fulfilled because he did not learn it by heart. Then she would fetch my wooden slate, which she had already washed and plastered with yellow chalk, a tiny earthen pink ink pot and a red pen, tied them all in a bundle and hand it to me. So all these things, arrangements were made by her. She got them all ready and made him ready for school. After breakfast of thick stale chapati with a little butter and sugar spread on it, we went to school. So they had this very simple breakfast, which most people of the villages have: stale chapati, butter and sugar. And she carried several stale chapatis with her for the village dogs. Now, very important thing: she feeds the stray animals. Does her duty towards society. It's our duty to look after these stray animals of the society. She does fulfills her duty towards her grandson, fulfills her duty towards the society by feeding the stray animals. My grandmother always went to school with me because the school was attached to the temple. The priest taught us the alphabet and the morning prayer. This was done by the village priest. He taught them the alphabets, he taught them the morning prayer. While the children sat in rows on either side of the veranda singing the alphabet or the prayer in chorus, my grandmother sat inside reading the scriptures. So you see, the grandmother is very religious minded. She reads the scriptures all the time that the boys out there in the temple school are going through the alphabets and reading the morning prayers. When we had both finished, we would walk back together. This time the village dogs would meet us at the temple door. They followed us to our home, growling and fighting with each other for the chapatis we threw at them. So this was the regular habit. They used to constantly follow the grandmother and the grandson. They knew that they were going to give them food, and the food that they threw, they used to fight among each other. When my parents were comfortably settled in the city, they sent for us. This was a turning point in our friendship. Now the friendship will undergo a twist, a turn, a change. Although we shared the same room, my grandmother no longer came to school with me. Why? I used to go to an English school in a motor bus. Now a school bus is taking the child to school. See, here there is the generation gap, here is their alienation. They share the same room, but grandmother no longer accompanies him to school. Why? He is going there by school bus with all of his friends. So herein the link is getting broken up. I used to go to an English school in a motor bus. There were no dogs in the streets, and she took to feeding sparrows in the courtyard in the city house. In the city house, there were no dogs, or she couldn't have access to them. So she started feeding the sparrows, again doing her bit of duty towards those stray animals and creatures. As the years rolled by, we saw less of each other. Slowly but surely, he is developing, he is growing up, he is having new friends, and slowly this bond with grandmother is weakening and very less communication. For some time, she continued to wake me up and get me ready for school. This was her habit, she used to do that. When I came back, she would ask me what the teacher had taught me. I would tell her English words and little things of Western science and learning, the laws of gravity, Archimedes' principle, the world being round, etc. So all these things which he is learning at school, he used to communicate it to his grandmother. But the grandmother was unable to, she was not educated like the boy. And so she did not have knowledge of all these things. This made her unhappy. She could not help me with my lessons. Earlier in the village school, they used to teach the basic alphabets, the morning prayer and all such religious things. There, the grandmother could help him. Now she is unhappy because she is unable to help him with his lessons. She did not believe in the things they taught me in the English school and was distressed. There was no teaching about God and the scriptures. So she could not help, she was distressed about it. And one more reason for being distressed is that the religious teachings were absent. That is what troubled her very much. One day I announced that we were being given music lessons. She was very disturbed. To her, music had lewd associations. So when one day he announced that he was being given music lessons, she was shocked. Because music lessons music was not looked upon well. It was very low graded kind of a thing. See, it was the monopoly of the harlots and beggars and not meant for gentle folk. That was the older view, older perception or superstition that she has, that music is related only to harlots and such courtesans, and also to beggars who sing and beg for money. It is not meant for gentle people. She said nothing, but a silence meant disapproval. She rarely talked to me after that. So after that, she very rarely talked to the narrator. When I went up to university, I was given a room of my own. Now that he has crossed over to teenage and he is now in university, college and all. So now he is given a separate room from the grandmother. Now there is more alienation, more separation. The grandmother is now all the more lonely. The common link of friendship was snapped. See, the common link is snapped. My grandmother accepted her seclusion with resignation. When she has lost her husband, she is all alone. She accepted this seclusion, this loneliness also with resignation. Of course, it will be like that. Sons will grow up and they will go away. Grandsons will grow up, they will leave me. So it's a resignation. It's a acceptance. She really left her spinning wheel to talk to anyone. The charkha that you see Gandhiji weaving, that spinning wheel she used to weave, and she didn't talk with anyone. She just continued with the job. From sunrise to sunset, she sat by her wheel, spinning and reciting prayers. So, somewhat like Satyagraha aspect, she started spinning the wheel, reciting prayers and all that. Only in the afternoon, she detached for a while to feed the sparrows. While she sat in the veranda, breaking the bread into little bits, hundreds of little birds collected around her, creating a veritable bedlam of chirpings. All the birds used to come and there used to be a whole lot of chirpings, a bedlam of chirpings, like you have a class without a teacher. You have a noisy classroom, of course. A veritable bedlam of chirpings. That means if you have a class of students without a teacher, of course it will be a very noisy class with all kinds of different noises coming out of it. So similarly, when the birds used to gather here, there would be a lot of chirpings of various wavelengths. That was what was the sound that used to come out, because all the birds were very happy. They were being fed by the grandmother. They loved her very much, and that's why these were the cries of happiness. Some came and perched on her legs, others on her shoulders, some even sat on her head. She smiled, but she never shooed them away. That means she's a lover of animals. Earlier she loved the street dogs, now she loves the sparrows. So she loves animals, she has care for nature and the animals. So when they sat on her head or on her shoulders or legs, she didn't shoo them away. It used to be the happiest half hour of the day for her. So for her, this was the happiest half hour of the day. When I decided to go abroad for further studies, I was sure my grandmother would be upset. I would be away for 5 years, and at her age, one could never tell. So then the narrator graduated and is going to go for further studies for 5 years out of the country, abroad. And he thought grandmother would be very upset, because at her old age, there's no guarantee that she will stay alive for the next 5 years. So he is very tensed about it. He thought she grandmother would be very upset, but no, she didn't say anything. But my grandmother could. She was not even sentimental. It was as if the grandmother knew she is not going to die. So she was not at all sentimental. She came to leave me at the railway station, but did not talk or show any emotion. She did not show any emotion. She did not talk. She did not do anything. She just came at the railway station. Her lips moved in prayer, but her mind was lost in prayer. So her mind was lost in prayer. Her lips were moving in prayer. And we can easily guess, these prayers are for the well-being of the grandson. He may have a safe journey, he may have nice education, he may be prosperous in life. All this is for his well-being, not for her. Her fingers were busy telling the beads of the rosary. Silently she kissed my forehead, and when I left, I cherished the moist imprint as perhaps the last sign of physical contact between us. So, just as he was leaving, she embraced him and kissed his forehead, and he thought this is probably the last physical contact, last physical touch that I am having with my grandmother. Probably when I come, she will be dead. So he cherished it, he kind of treasured it very much. But that was not so. But his belief was wrong. He thought that after 5 years when I come, grandmother would be dead, but no, he was wrong. After 5 years I came back home and was met by her at the station. 5 years back he came, and the grandmother is there at the station. She did not look a day older. She did not look to be older, even for a day. She still had no time for words. And while she clasped me in her arms, I could hear her reciting her prayers. Again, see, she embraces him and is happy that he is back, and again reciting prayers to God, thanking him for bringing him back safely, for the safe, for the prosperous life that he has, and all that things. She is paying for that. Even on the first day of my arrival, her happiest moments were with the sparrows, whom she fed longer and with frivolous rebukes. Again, the half hour that she has reserved for the sparrows, that is there, and that day also she fed the sparrows, and with frivolous rebukes, with jokingly rebuking them, just as we jokingly or lovingly scold our children. Similarly, they were like her children, and she used to frivolously rebuke them, means scolding them, and frivolously means a bit lovingly and jokingly. In the evening, a change came over her. She did not pray. She collected the women of the neighborhood, got an old drum, and started to sing. For several hours, she thumped the sagging strings of the dilapidated drum and sang of the homecoming of warriors. Suddenly, she got the women of the neighborhood together, got hold of a dilapidated drum, very not so good condition drum. It's in a kind of a broken down condition. The skin was flagging. It was loose. Normal drums have very tight skin. So with that sagging skin of the drum, she continued singing of the homecoming of warriors. We had to persuade her to stop, to avoid overstraining. She's not used to all this singing, so they had to stop her from overstraining herself. That was the first time since I had known her that she did not pray. This was probably the first day that narrator says that I have seen her not praying. The next morning she was taken ill. It was a mild fever, and the doctor told us that it would go. The doctor came, looked at her and said, okay, it's a mild fever, it will go away. But my grandmother thought differently. She told us her end was near. Grandmother thought, no, my end is near. I'm going to die very soon. She said that since only a few hours before the close of the last chapter of her life, she had omitted to pray, she was not going to waste any more time talking to us. She said, look, a few hours before my death, I am not going to waste in talking to you. I'm going to spend it in praying. Because already last evening I have missed out on my prayer and everything. Today I'm not going to waste time in talking to you all. I'm going to devote this time in prayer. We protested, but she ignored our protest. She lay peacefully in bed, praying and telling her beads. Even before we could suspect, her lips stopped moving and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. A peaceful pallor spread on her face and we knew that she was dead. So as she was telling the beads gently, her lips were moving, and suddenly her lips stopped moving. The rosary that she had in her hands, it became lifeless. It was no longer moving. The fingers were not moving. She was not counting the beads anymore. They were lifeless, the fingers. A peaceful pallor spread on her face. A peaceful color seemed to have come on her face. And we knew she was dead. We lifted her off the bed as is customary, laid her on the ground and covered her with a red shroud, a red cloth they covered her with. After a few hours of mourning, we left her alone to make arrangements for the funeral. So all the arrangements for the funeral, they all went to make. She was left all alone in the room. In the evening, we went to her room with a crude stretcher to take her to be cremated. So they went with a crude stretcher, you know, it is made with bamboos and all. They went with that to take her to the crematorium for to be cremated. The sun was setting and had lit her room and veranda with a blaze of golden light. The golden light of the sun had filled her room entirely. We stopped halfway in the courtyard, all over the veranda and in her room, right up to where she lay dead and stiff, wrapped in the red shroud. Thousands of sparrows lay scattered on the floor. So they were shocked to see thousands of sparrows all around. They were all around the courtyard, the room and everywhere. There was no chirping. We felt sorry for the birds and my mother fetched some bread for them. She broke it into little crumbs the way my grandmother used to and threw it to them. The sparrows took no notice of the bread. So very strangely and very emotional aspect, the birds did not touch the food. They were in sorrow, in agreement of sorrow with the other household members on the death of the grandmother. They were all around. Mother thought that they are hungry, that's why they have come. So she gave them bread just as the way grandmother used to, but they did not touch the food. When we carried my grandmother's corpse off, they flew away quietly. Not a single chirrup was heard. They flew away quietly once the dead body was taken. Next morning, the sweeper swept the breadcrumbs into the dustbin. And the next morning, they were all swept away. That means the whole chapter is over of grandmother. And the sweeping away of the breadcrumbs also signifies that from next day onwards, the birds are also probably not going to come. As well as the fact that grandmother is now no longer here. So the birds are not going to be fed anymore because we do not have any mention. Now we come to an analysis of the story, if we may judge it in this way. It's on the one hand, it celebrates the childhood. Now childhood is, of course, we are talking of those joint families wherein you had a lot of other cousins, you had uncles, aunts, you had people like grandparents spending those lovely years. We are talking of that. It celebrates that. The story is narrated by the narrator of the years which he had spent. And it is presented from his eyes, the way he sees the grandmother. Okay, the grandson's perception of his grandmother is revealed, and how their bond of love undergoes a change. Gradual change we have seen throughout the story, how there is a change in their friendship from the time when he goes to the village school to the English medium school, then to university and all that. There's a gradual change. So that is one of the aspects of the story, the friendship between the grandson and the grandmother. Next is generation gap. Of course, there is a generation gap. gradually you see in the story, the grandmother is separated from the grandson, and not only that, she is all alone. She says that she didn't talk to anyone, she was always on the spinning wheel, she was always praying. So the family members gave her very little time. Not only the grandson, who was of course busy, the grandson's father, that is the her children, the son-in-law, or whoever it is, the daughter-in-law, anyone of the family, no one of the family had gave too much time to her. So then creates that generation gap. The story sheds light on the need of companionship and friendship by the elders. Of course, that is what is one of the important themes. These old people, they are often sent to the old age homes, but there are great guides and treasure houses of knowledge and information and guidance for the children, younger ones in particular. So they need to be there in the household, but at the same time they need to be given some kind of friendship, companionship and all that is missing. It also shows how love and emotion is experienced not only by human beings but also animals and birds as well. Towards the end of the story, you have seen the sparrows, they coming and expressing their sadness. Not a single cheer up was heard. They did not take that breadcrumbs that was given. So there is another example of it. Other things including innocence. You have the innocence at the beginning of the story, wherein the narrator says he fails to imagine his grandmother as a young girl or as a bride, or the grandfather as someone who is maybe 100 years old, who could not be a father, could not be imagined to be a father, having children and wife or a husband. So these things are full of innocence. Then he says that for 20 years she has remained the same, and she has not aged. So all these things are signs of his innocence. Friendship, of course, the friendship is highlighted between the narrator and the grandmother. They share a strong bond, particularly at the beginning when he is going to the village school. That period of time when he is in the village, there is a strong bond. Everything is done by the grandmother. He is very much dependent on the grandmother. From waking up in the morning to the breakfast, lunch, everything, and guidance in terms of studies, everything is done by the grandmother. Connection, the narrator has connection with the grandmother, of course. There's a great connection between them, that's why he is always there with the grandmother. Likewise, grandmother has close connection with God and feels relaxed in prayer and meditation. That is her only solace. When all the family members have kind of deserted her and she is all alone without any companion, her husband is dead, what she could do? She takes recourse to prayer, meditation and the spinning of the wheel and all that for her own comfort, relaxation, peace, contentment. She takes recourse to that. She is selfless and helps dogs and later on sparrows. Of course, her selflessness and her duty towards the society, as I told earlier, is also highlighted here. The grandmother wears white all the time, which symbolizes her purity. The narrator feels his grandmother is both beautiful and pure. And that is what is said when he compares her with that white snow-clad mountains and that serene picture he paints of the grandmother moving around the house in white. That is what is symbolized here. So he says that she is very beautiful, beautiful in that aspect. And nowhere in the story do you find the grandson criticizing. There is no mention of any quarrel that he had with the grandmother, or anywhere where he criticizes his grandmother. Even when she criticizes him for learning music and all that, he in return doesn't criticize her. Okay, so that's one more important thing. And towards the end, the narrator accepts the death of the grandmother. She has lived her good life. He is left with memories of the happy times he has spent with her. So he accepts her death and says, okay, fine, she has grown old, she has lived a happy life, now she is dead. Those happy memories that I have, which I treasure, they will remain with me forever. He will never forget her and is grateful to her for all that she has done for her. Of course, he will remain grateful because the budding years, the childhood years of his life, he had spent with his grandmother. It is she who has guided him. So he will, of course, remain grateful to her always. From a young man to a grown-up adult, she has always been there for him. So that is why for the rest of his life, never can he forget his grandmother. So that's the story, the portrait of the lady I've tried to explain. And if you still have any doubts, write to me in the comment section and like and share this video and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for your love and support. Thanks for watching.